Okay, so welcome along to our second session, the main event of the night on Copilot for partners. So the first thing I'll say in this is that this is, for SMB anyway, for SMB partners, this is a relatively new topic. It's changing regularly, it's being renamed. The information will probably be out of date by next week. So take all of that on board. The other side of this is, you know, we're still working out a lot of this stuff, as in, you know, how the licensing works, how the technology works in the background, what works well, what doesn't work well. So again, it's still very, very immature, as in the experiences out there. So my advice is always, you know, ask the question, understand it, but it still is very, very early days for a lot of this stuff. Now, if you look at the adoption of technology as a race to 100 million users, this is a common benchmark that people have. And again, the example is Facebook, as big as it is, took 4.5 years, whereas ChatGPT took, you know, a whole of 3 months to get to that level. So is this a fad? Is this here for real? Very interesting, but there is no doubt in any way, shape or form that this is being adopted left, right and center. And it's being adopted on a very wide scale. Now, you know, stats prove nothing at the end of the day, or they can prove anything you want. But I think the takeaway for partners is that there'll be very few customers who A, aren't aware of AI, and B, have not heard someone else of influence to them saying, you should have AI, you'll make things better or make things faster. This is the way to go. You can save time, money, effort, reduce this, blah, blah, blah. So at the end of the day, a lot of the marketing, a lot of the hype, a lot of the, you know, stories already done, you know, current affair stuff. And when your parents start asking you about AI, then you know it's generally reached general adoption. So again, keep that in mind that this is, you know, all the marketing's been done for you. Now in the Microsoft space, there is, you know, multiple ways to go about AI. All of it is based on effectively, you know, servers in Azure data centers. They are surfacing AI or giving the AI capabilities via different mechanisms. So we have the capability to use the Power Platform. So things like Power Automate, Power Apps, all of that have, you know, Copilot built into it. Also Dynamics, which is sales, which is accounts, which is all sorts of stuff in there, is also Copilot enabled. So typically Copilot for sales there. Microsoft 365, which we'll talk about. Security Copilot to me, which we'll talk about at the end, is the killer Copilot in SMB without any doubt, or in IT in general. It is the killer Copilot. It's just going to change the world, in my opinion, when we finally get our hands on it, which may be a while down the track, and I'll tell you why. If you haven't got Windows 11, then you may not have received a Copilot on the desktop. I don't know how particularly powerful it is, rather than turning things on and off, but the concept is the integration, right? So Microsoft is trying to get people to understand that Microsoft is the AI company, all of it's linked together. I see the day when the Copilot on the desktop is linked to the Copilot in the cloud. So, you know, that's a starting point. My understanding is that, you know, everybody in Microsoft has been told you have to have a Copilot for your service. So whether you're Dynamics, whether you're Windows, whether you're Azure, whether you're whatever, you have to have a Copilot for your service. Obviously, Bing is the front-facing or the consumer-facing you know, capability of Copilot. And the other big one, which we'll have a look at, is Copilot in GitHub, which helps you write code and do a number of other things as well. Now, of course, the OpenAI service is available as well. That integrates into Azure. You can use it directly. You can pay an API, pay for a fee. Microsoft has contributed 49% of the costs of all AI or owns it. It's a really interesting relationship where it's a not-for-profit arm and a profit arm and, you know, blah, 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 blah. So you can go into all the dramas around the CEO and Sam Altman and all that sort of stuff. However, at the end of the day, you know, Microsoft largely is ensconced there and is using, you know, those sort of models plus their own. Now, we want to talk about Microsoft Copilot. And I think if you think about it, it's a very good naming. Microsoft finally come up with a good name, apart from OneDrive and SkyDrive and all those challenges it has about Defender and different sorts of Defender. I think the concept of Copilot being an assistant is a really good one, right? If you want help with Excel, if you want help with code, if you want help with CRM, get the Copilot for it. So I think it's got a really good brand. Now, that said, unfortunately, as with Microsoft, is what's happened is that it is now flooding the market with this good brand. So I think the last count I saw, there's something like 125 Copilots that Microsoft makes available. Right. So is it this Copilot or that Copilot? All of those are going to have an individual SKU identifier and all that sort of stuff. Sorry, you're not seeing the deck. That would have been good. I thought I was sharing it. Let's try again. Thank you very much for letting me know. I thought I was sharing the deck. Nobody pulled me up. Where's that person, Wayne Small? Okay. Let me just verify. Can you see the deck now, Don? Cool. Sorry about that, guys. You'll get a copy of the deck afterwards. They're just PowerPoint slides, so don't worry about it. They're just pretty PowerPoint slides that were put together that I stole from a Microsoft deck, but you will get the deck afterwards. So again, good naming convention there. And I think that, you know, it's perhaps being a bit overdone now by Microsoft, but, you know, at the end of the day, it is, you know, going to be a well-known brand, I think. Now, it was announced on January the 16th. It's available through all channels, so enterprise agreement, CSP, and buying it direct. The prerequisites are you effectively need a studio, a suite, so you need Business Standard, Business Premium, Office 365, Academic 365. You need the suite of apps, Outlook, Excel, Word, PowerPoint, Exchange, those sort of things. And there's no minimum purchase. You can buy just one. It used to be limited to 300. And the idea is that now you can buy it as a single, you know, a single license if you want. So the prerequisites are not that earth-shattering. You know, you need to have Microsoft 365 apps, so Word, Excel, PowerPoint, SharePoint, OneDrive, blah, blah, blah. You need to have your identity managed by Entra ID, Azure AD, and you need the storage mechanism of OneDrive and things like Teams, Loop, Whiteboard, all of that sort of stuff. So again, all of this lights up through the Microsoft suite. So you can't buy, for example, Exchange Online and on its own as a single license and then use Copilot. It needs the prerequisite of the whole suite. And you could say in a way that perhaps the idea is that, you know, that is upselling stuff, but it makes sense because when you look at what Copilot can do, it needs the document storage, it needs the emails, it needs the other thing. We got a question from Lev, I think. So let's go into here and let's allow the microphone. Okay, Lev, your microphone is, do you want to unmute your microphone if you do have a question? No, Lev's gone somewhere. No, there he is.
All good.
No, off.
All good. No, it's just a mistake. Sorry. I just wanted to say that we can see your screen. Sorry.
Excellent. We're back again. Okay, so thanks for that. Double check. It's always good to do a parity check there to make sure that we basically have that capability now. We can see the slides. My mistake. I'm blaming Wayne for that, so that's fine. So here are the technical requirements. You'll get a list of it. You'll get the slides afterwards. But at the end of the day, again, E5, E3, Business Premium, Business Standard, no Business Basic. You need OneDrive, SharePoint to put files and for it to move across. You need, you know, Outlook, Teams, Word on the desktop to do that. Now, as mentioned, many, many Copilots. So Microsoft has a Copilot free, okay, which is just basically Bing, and it has makes that available to do chat, to do diagrams, all that sort of stuff, allows you to do basic chat GPT sort of stuff. You can then pay $20 US a user to go to Copilot Pro. Now, that gives you an additional priority, which means you can use chat GPT 4 rather than 3, and you can now integrate it with your code with Outlook, Word, and Excel, even if you don't have a Microsoft 365 environment. Now, yes, $20 is US is pretty expensive. However, if you think about the costs at the back end of what this is, Microsoft is probably at the moment not encouraging everybody to sign up and try it and, you know, basically over, to melt down their data centers. They're probably trying to drip feed it out, and only the people who are the most keen are going to pay that amount of money. And it's also a well-known business strategy like Tesla. You sell to the hot people who will pay the most, then you work your way down over time to everybody else. So I think that's basically why that's happening. And of course, we've got Copilot for Microsoft 365, where you need Microsoft 365, business premium, whatever, to do it. And that's $30, which is roughly 45, Australian dollars to do that. So again, one or many inside an organization. Now, when you go into your, if you're going to purchase at retail, you just go into your marketplace, you look at the product, do a search for Copilot, make sure you get the right Copilot, as mentioned, because there are many Copilots, and all you need to do is select, one, two, three licenses, but the limitation, as has been discussed, is you need to sign up for a minimum 1 year upfront. All right, so you're going to have to prepay for a year of at least 1 year to get access to this, typically in a commercial purchase with a credit card. And you'll see down the bottom, that's going to cost me $538 ex GST. So add GST, we get towards $600. So in essence, if you want to try it, if your customers want to use it, it's going to cost them, about $600, including GST minimum for the year. You can buy it with CSP. The margin on CSP is next to nothing. So you're not going to make money selling Copilots, even worse or even lower than most of the other SKUs you probably sell. So there's no money largely in selling Copilot licenses. So again, but it's very simple to add. You can do it with a credit card. The idea with Copilot is you can, use the large language models. The key, I think, is integration with the graph. So Microsoft has what's known as a data graph, which sort of records or has the ability to look at your email interactions, your file access, and this is what you can leverage and integrate with. Also allows the parties to get to it and to interface as well. We can also use our Microsoft apps, as well as we can integrate it with, the stuff out of there on the internet. And typically most users are going to do this through Word, Excel, PowerPoint, Teams, Outlook, and so on. All right, so it's just going to be integrated in the apps. We'll have a look at how to do this. So I'll run through this quickly. You can go through and read all this, but the idea is that you can use Copilot to catch up on meetings you've missed, or read emails, or do data analysis, or create content and email processing. So an example is, if you've been on Christmas holidays, you've come back, you've got lots and lots of emails, you can just ask Copilot to give you a summary or tell you what the most important ones are. So that's an example of what it can do. It can create content for you, it can answer an email in a certain tone, it can do all sorts of things, and we'll have a look at that in detail. But think of it as a processing capability, a research capability, and a content creation capability. Now, of course, you can also target this by function. So HR people will get benefit, marketing, sales, IT, finance, and so on. Now, I would suggest to you that Copilot is largely not something that will be targeted at every user. Okay. It's going to be inside each business, there's going to be at least one person whose job is to create stuff, whether it's financial reports, marketing, emails, customer service, whatever. That's the person you should be targeting. Okay, especially initially. I don't think in the long term, eventually probably they will sell it to everybody else, but don't feel the necessity to go in there and have to force it down everybody's throats. I don't think it's for everybody. I think it's for one or two key users initially in a business, and then it will probably, go out from there. Okay, so the idea is that, it's not a for everyone license, I would suggest. All right, but you can if you want, but I would suggest you target individual key users who will get the most benefit, and they'll sell it to others. So the idea here is that the Microsoft Copilot, largely think of it as search engine version 5. It uses all the data that is in your environment from accesses it via typically by the graph connectors. And it builds, so when you enable it for the first time, it builds what's called a semantic index. So a semantic index, for example, is how you use your language, the tone you use in your emails. It builds all of that uniquely. Now, when you put it in day one, it's probably not going to be as responsive as day two, day seven, day 14. So this semantic index does take time to build and will depend obviously on the amount of data that's in the tenant. So the more data, the longer it'll take to build, but it needs to build this semantic index to really get the best from it. Now, as mentioned, it's going to pull information from the graph. Now, we can do this with PowerShell. We can do this with Power Automate. All of these tools access the graph and make API calls and gets all sorts of wonderful information, send stuff backwards and forwards. So at its core, you know, I would suggest that, you know, part of the understanding is to have some sort of concept of what the graph is about, a basics of how it works, a basics of how it permissions, how you manage the APIs, what to look for. Because we all know the bad guys are going to target, you know, these sort of capabilities, these services, and try and inject themselves in there to do that. So having a good understanding of how this works, because remember, we're moving very fastly from, right, the concept of hardware infrastructure to software. It's all about software. It's all about APIs. It's all about items which aren't a person logging into your data. Okay, so indexing data, that's all happening without a person actually logging it in. Okay, so obviously, Don, at the end of the day, there are bazillion documents from Microsoft about how it's secured. Your semantic thing is lives wherever your tenant is based. So if your tenant is in Australia, your semantic thing will live in Australia. If you're in the EU, your index will live in the EU and abide by all the compliance, all the capabilities, all the security that Microsoft provides in Microsoft 365. At the end of the day, Copilot is built on all those other technologies, Azure AD, conditional access, labeling, compliance, SOC, HIPAA, all that sort of stuff. It is built on that. And that's one of the big benefits Microsoft has. It's able to keep that data, you know, secure based on what it's already built in Microsoft 365, because it really is just the existing data. So as mentioned, the semantic index just sits on top of the graph. It uses that to, you know, make all its intelligence about you, and it can, you know, recognize things like synonyms, other factors, all that sort of stuff. So it's sort of a smart search technology basically on the top. So Don's asking whether the index could be stolen. I wouldn't think so, because the index is quite large and it is not a single file. And it is a spidered concept of pulling information from various APIs. At the end of the day, anything's possible, right? It's data stored somewhere, but I think you'll find that it's just a huge table of unrecognizable connections, but I don't know enough about it to comment that, but I think it's highly unlikely that the index could be taken. So I've linked to these videos rather than playing them for you. I suggest you go in and have a look at them. So this will explain the semantic index for Copilot. It'll also explain the Copilot system. Great little videos. You can send them to customers as well. I'll run through a couple of apps here and we'll get to the demos. So obviously Copilot in Outlook. The limitation of that turns out to be is Copilot will only operate in the new Outlook. Okay, so I know there are not many fans of that around, and I'm not one of them, I agree. But if you do want to use Copilot in Outlook, answer emails, do all that sort of stuff, then you're going to have to use the new Outlook. I would suggest to you that a better option is to use it in the OWA. You know, Outlook Web Access is a better option, perhaps for the time being. But just remember, at the moment, it's all new stuff. It's all required to have new technologies. So again, you'll get these. There we go. Okay, so all these videos I can make available too if you want them. And again, they're good for little customer things. So the idea is to select prompts and answer emails using a certain tone, pretty straightforward. It's really good in Teams because it can summarize meetings. It can bring you up to date. If you have a meeting like this, you can go in and ask Copilot, where was semantic index mentioned? And it will then give you that inside your meetings. It can bring you up to date. Even if you didn't attend a meeting, as long as it's a recording, it can read. And also what I'm keen to see is how it can be used as a knowledge base to ask questions. If you've got a whole lot of conversations in Teams around, you know, Azure, Microsoft 365, all that sort of stuff, can I ask it a question? And it comes back with a knowledge base. So think of it like more like an expert system, I would suggest, right? So I think it could have a great option, a great option there. Intelligent recap, as mentioned, giving you update. You know, if you attend a lot of meetings or a lot of webinars, this will give you that summary, what's important based on your needs, and so on. So rather than having to dig through that individually, you can ask Copilot to go in and do that for you. The examples here is, you know, what I've missed in a meeting, the pros and cons of a topic, what decisions were made, what tasks were allocated to people. Again, you can use it in your chat. You can use it in Loop, which is, you know, sort of basically the, you know, the idea that rather than using, so like if you've used Notion or if you used a more online embeddable sort of OneNote, I suppose, that's sort of what Loop is. But again, they're building this all into their newer technologies. So Whiteboard, Loop, all that sort of stuff, it comes in natively because it's a, you know, it's a cloud, you know, cloud leading sort of thing. All right, so Copilot in Word is probably where you're going to see the most use of it. You know, create me an email, create a Word document on this, base it on this. I'll show you a demo of this. PowerPoint's another one. Create, you know, these sort of presentations. Excel's another really good example. You know, you've got a set of numbers and you want to analyze it. You want to do a pivot table. You don't know how to do a pivot table. I think Excel, you know, it means that you don't have to be an Excel wonk to get the benefits out of it. So you've just given a whole lump of data and you need to produce results and have a look at that and, you know, all of that sort of stuff. Okay. So, you know, at the end of the day, I think it's going to have the biggest basis probably in, you know, Outlook and then Word and Excel for, you know, individual users who are creating stuff. Again, we've got it in chat, which I'll show you. So that's like a chat GPT style environment for your Microsoft sort of 365. Microsoft has this Copilot Lab, which is training you on how to prompt the AI for better results. At the end of the day, like using search engines, okay? So the idea is you get the most out of a search engine when you know how to use it, when you use the right context, when you use the right syntax. Using AI is very much going to be the same. You need to ask it the right prompts and, you know, there is a process around that. So that's going to take a bit of learning, a bit of getting used to. So as always, there's always an AI checklist, but the key point that I pulled out here is you need to protect your sensitive data. Now, at the moment, you can run a search in Microsoft and it will spit back any data that hasn't been protected. Exactly the same thing with Copilot. It's just going to make it much, much easier to go and pull that information and potentially use it in other locations. So the key takeaway before implementing any of this is to make sure your customers and your environments are secured based on who needs access to stuff. That is the key thing, because effectively Copilot is largely just a search engine which is a bit more convenient. All right, and then the next step is okay, how do we use this stuff? How do we integrate it? How do we get it into all the client environments that we want to use? All right, so the building blocks are Entra ID, as always, Azure AD style login, the appropriate license, business premium is more than adequate. Then you've got, you know, Teams, the applications, OneDrive, SharePoint, those sort of things is where the document or where the data will largely be stored. And you want to make sure you have the layer on top of it that have your permissions, your restrictions, your policies, your DLP, you know, your low-level permissions to control the data, because if it's not controlled like a file share, you still can obviously analyze it and pull that out and do a search on it. And on top of that, you're going to have API connections to third-party data, to, you know, information protection, data retention. All of that will still apply because it's in the, you know, the Microsoft environment there. All right, so that's one of the benefits that's already in there. It's just, again, like I said, largely an improved search capability. All right. The idea is if we go in and use Bing Chat Enterprise, the idea is if we log in with our ID, we can have our data protected. So that's not then shared out publicly like ChatGPT is or used to train the model. So that's one of the benefits of using Bing Chat Enterprise. And the idea is that the data that you put into that is protected, won't be shared outside, you know, that environment. All right. So again, customers can start using that today. I'm not going to dwell on that. It's really handy for summarizing long PDF documents, you know, drafting emails and stuff if they want to do it. Now, of course, as I mentioned, Microsoft has renamed Bing Chat Enterprise is now called Copilot. Okay, so let me see if I can do a demo here without overexposing my data. So this is Bing Chat Enterprise or Copilot today. So this is, you'll see in the top right hand corner, I've logged in as my production ID here. And that means that the data, the information that I put in here is, you know, protected. It's not shared, you know, publicly with, you know, any of that. But before we get to that, if you haven't seen, you know, the granddaddy of it all is ChatGPT. So you can use ChatGPT, you can sign up for a, you know, a paid option here, and just to give you an idea. So if I take a prompt here, pump it in, you know, this is sort of what the output's going to be. So tell me about January the 23rd in history. Give me a list of 10 items here. Okay, now the key that I found is I can use an API to send information into ChatGPT, get a response, and tidy it up, put it anywhere I want. But the idea here is that I'm surprised by how many people are actually using ChatGPT, even the free version. Now you'll notice it's using the 3.5 engine. You can also upgrade if you want to and go to the 4 engine. This is where the cost and the concept of Copilot Pro is coming in. So the idea here is that we can go into Copilot with Bing and whatever they want to call it, I think now, and then we go in and put another prompt. Oops, sorry, my fault. I need to paste it in as text. Okay. So it can do things like, you know, teach me Japanese phrases, and you'll see you've got an option to make it more creative, more balanced, more precise. Remember, none of this is shared publicly or kept or tracked or whatever according, and you need to log in to your environment with that. So it's pretty cool. I like it. It will give you that specific answer, but in essence, you could probably get the same result if you did use a search engine. Also with Bing, you'll get these references. So you can go in and click, oh, where did you actually get this information from? So it'll give you those references. You can thumbs up, thumbs down, and so on. So all of that is available free. And if you do have a commercial license, you can log into it with that commercial license and get some additional protection with that, if you choose. Now, another one that Microsoft does have out there is Designer. All right, so I'm just going to get Designer. So that's, we can go in and create, images here. So designer.microsoft.com. And again, basically you just log in here and hopefully, let's see if it works. And the idea is you go in and describe your image and it will spit out that image for you or a rendering of it. And then you can use it wherever you want. Now, my understanding, and again, this I could be wrong here, my understanding is that anything you use or create with AI, and this could just be US law, I don't know how it applies in Australia just yet. My understanding at this point in time is anything created with generative AI, you can't copyright. So if I use this image and I wanted to copyright it to use it on my business, I don't believe I can do that or it wouldn't hold up in court. Now, don't quote me on it, but that is something to consider when you are looking at generative AI, maybe something to talk a bit to customers about. Now, to get into the really interesting and important stuff, I would suggest to you, this is my Visual Studio Code, and I have GitHub Copilot in here, okay? Now, this is a JSON file, and you'll notice that it is the license equals and the name of it, the text of it. Now, what I want to do is put a semicolon at the end of this. Now, this could be thousands of lines long. And putting a semicolon, doing a search and replace is quite challenging because you can't just simply quote inverted commas because that appears in other places. So to do search and replace actually does become quite challenging. However, with good old GitHub Copilot, so if I go Control I here, whoops, let me get back to the top. So we can see it, go Control I, and I put in the appropriate prompt. You'll see it goes away, it chews on it. And then what it should do is, let's say it goes through and you can see it adding a semicolon at the end of every line. So once it's done that, I just accept it and I update my code. So super, super handy for doing that sort of stuff, which I really struggled to do when I was doing it manually. So let's have a look at another example here. So let's say, for example, I want to do this. All right, so let's look at, close this off so you can see. Okay, so if I go in here and say, create me a PowerShell script to block shared mailboxes interactive logins. There is, I don't have to know anything about it. Off I go and I'm off to the races, right? Now keep that in mind when I do this. So not only can I do it in something like PowerShell, but what I can also do is I could just turn around and say, well, hang on, do it in Python for me. All right, and it's going to go off and do the same thing for me in Python, and I can save it, and then I'm off to the races. My point is not so much the actual mechanics of it. My point is how long would it have taken me to add semicolons at the end of every line? How long would it have taken me to work out, write this and get this in PowerShell? Then how long would it have taken me to do the same thing in Python? Yes, I could have done it. I looked up other things, I worked it out, find somebody else's GitHub. But at the end of the day, it's much easier to throw it out to the AI and get the AI to give me, you know, the answers for that. All right. So again, that's, I think, where the big savings are: creating things, updating things, summarizing things, you know, all that sort of stuff is really what it's all about here. So I think, let's see. Okay. So if you see anything that you shouldn't see, make sure you close your eyes, because again, to get the most out of this, this is another challenge, is I have to buy Copilot and use it in my production environment, okay? So the idea here is that I have to use my own production data to show you a demo of it, and there's no Microsoft CDX environment, there's no real demos. You have to put in your own environment, which has real data and does stuff, to do demos, so that's a challenge. So when I put Copilot in here, you'll see I get a Copilot tab. This is a chat GPT style portal that I've logged into. This is looking at my data, plus potentially looking at the internet stuff as well. So if we go in here, and let's hope some of these prompts don't accidentally reveal something they're not supposed to. So if I go in here and say, generate a summary of a terms of engagement PDF. So in my environment, in one of my SharePoint sites somewhere, there is a generic terms of engagement PDF. All right, so you can see that it's going off, having a think, it finds that document, and now it comes back and gives me a summary of that. All right, so yeah, that's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. I don't mind that. That's pretty great. Remember, this is a chat GPT style environment. So that will go off and keep generating and giving me a summary. That's great. So I'm going to stop that. It could continue on, obviously. If I go in here and I say, okay, complete a new document using the templates. I've got a template, which is terms of engagement for a business with address, blah, 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 blah. Right. So I'm going to go in here and tell it to create a new document to do that. So it's going to look at the docx rather than the PDF. It's going to hopefully work out where the customer's name and the customer's address should be in that template, and then go in and, you know, generate a, you know, a document for me. All right. So again, it's very helpful. It tells you what it's going to do. And then what it's going to do here is it's going to come back and say, here's the terms of engagement. This is an agreement between blah, blah, blah. And you'll notice that, yes, the template has, it has put in the name, it has put in the address, yada, 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 so I could put all that in. But you will notice at this point in time, it's going to give me this as an email. It didn't actually create a Word document, okay? So it's not a perfect system, just be aware of that. But when it finishes, I can copy and paste it and stick it into the document. But that's pretty cool. I like how it goes in and fills in the details for me when I am sort of specific here. So let's have a look at another one here. Remember, this is just a chat style interface. So if we go in here and say, you know, I've got a certificate of registration of my business name, okay, and I want to convert that from a PDF to a Word. That's a fairly straightforward sort of process, one would think. All right, so what it's going to do is it's going to say, oh, sorry, I can't do that, but it's going to tell me how to do it. Right, so it's going to be able to say, well, I can't do that, but here's how you could do it, or here's where you go over and do it. So no, it's not magic, right? It won't magically do everything. It's not going to replace people on the line here, okay? But it's certainly going to be pretty handy and helpful, I would, you know, I would basically go in and suggest. So that's the ChatGPT Copilot inside Microsoft 365 interface. Now, if we go into, for example, Word, so this is Word on the web, you'll see here that once I've integrated, I get a Copilot button in the top right-hand corner here. It allows me to bring up Copilot, and you'll see that now it's prompting me and saying, okay, let's draft something with Copilot. So if I select that and I go in here, and remember that prompt that I used about creating a new document using, you know, that terms of engagement. So now I'm inside Word rather than inside a chat interface. All right, so it's going to, and you're going to see the other thing too with all this, it's not instantaneous. It's got to go off and make a unique request in the back of it. But this is pretty cool. Right. So you'll see that it's taken that template, it's put in the, you know, the company details in the right place, it creates the document, blah, 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 and then it will, you know, go off and you know, basically finish doing that. So that can save a lot of time and effort if you're creating these, you know, these documents on a regular basis. All right. So another one here is, for example, is if we take our request here to convert that PDF into Word. So we're now in Word. Let's see what that does. Let's see what it tells us to do. And importantly, once again, if you haven't got patience, Copilot's going to push it to the limit here because it does take a while for it to churn through all this, pull it, do graph API lookups. But you'll see it does a pretty good job. So when I'm in the application that can do PDF conversions, not too bad. All right. So, you know, I think that's part of the secret here too, is to get specific. But where it really comes into its own is I'm creating, you know, new content. All right. So in this case, what I want to do is create a course outline for advanced SharePoint training course that focuses on collaboration. Go generate. So this is, I don't generally have any of this as a document inside my production environment. And it's going to go out and look at the stuff that I've got in OneNote and also in Word and wherever. And it's going to come up with this thing for me. And then I just save it and I'm off to the races. So again, pretty impressive when you want to, again, create, edit, change, you know, update stuff as well. So if we turn our attention quickly to Excel, all right, so here's Excel. Again, you'll see that there's a Copilot button over in the right. We just select that. That'll launch our little Copilot. This is the concept of Copilot sitting on, you know, as an assistant to you. And you'll see here that it'll give you, you know, a number of things that's already worked out here. So the total number of engaged users, yada, yada, yada. And then down here, you'll be able to click, you know, prompts or whatever that it suggests for you. So show me some data insights. And it's got to understand my data. And then it'll do a chart and whatever. So remember, the idea here is if I'm not an Excel expert, if I'm not a charting expert, if I'm not a pivot table expert, you'll see it can do all this sort of stuff for me. So once it's done this, this button would allow me to add it as a new sheet. So it does most of the work basically for me. All right, so it has all of those capabilities in there, you know, show me all the insights for the grid. And remember, it's going to be saving this because we're in the web, you know, on the in the background for us as well. All right, so all of this will be integrated into here. It's created a new sheet for us. We can save this, update our information. Copilot's done the majority of work, you know, the majority of work for us here. Now, just going back to the chat here. Whoop, not that one. The integrated one I want, which I think hopefully I can get to here. No, not that one. Let's try this one. There we go. The other thing you'll notice here is this little button here that can view the prompt. So this is going to give you suggestions from the Copilot lab on a prompts you've saved and any prompts you want to use to help you with your information. Okay, so these are the ones that it reckons will work well. You can select the option down here called Go to Copilot Lab. That will open up, you know, another prompting engine here that is based sort of on your data, on your usage that you can use. So this is known as Copilot Lab. And the idea is to go in and give you better ideas on what are the right sort of prompts to, you know, go and ask. All right, so I think I got away with that with not exposing too many secrets there. So just to finish off quickly, the prompts, this is really all about prompts, right? It's not a new technology in any really way, shape or form. It's really just a glorified search engine. So what you ask is what you get out, garbage in, garbage out sort of thing. So good questions. And there is a particular methodology that you should use or that is recommended to get the most out of the prompts, right? So goal, context, source, expectations. So that's the sort of thing that's worth learning. The other thing to point out here is the extensibility. Because it's built on the graph, you've got the ability to reach into Teams, reach into the Power Platform, integrate with the Power Platform, integrate with OpenAPI plugins, whether it's OpenAPI or with through Azure. All right, so you can start off with what's built in Copilot for Microsoft 365, and then you can extend it with, you know, your old, you know, with your own integrations, APIs, Power Platform knowledge, third-party products, so you can use that to address your data as long as you've got that interface into there. And as mentioned, you can also go and start customizing this using Copilot Studio. So this is bots, basically bots based on Copilot. So it can have a bot and answer a question for you using all the Copilot goodness, and you configure that, you know, basically using a Power Platform capability. So all the links here are available, and another set of things to learn here, and yet more. So what I did is I wasn't able to export the whole, the whole PowerPoint in one hit to a PDF. Unfortunately, it had some sort of issue, and GitHub, where I store the presentations, has a limit on 25 meg, and this is far bigger than that with the videos in there. However, what I've done is I've taken all those links and hopefully the most important parts, and I've PDF them. I stuck them up here in bit.ly/CIA-copilot-partners. Go in there, have a look around. That'll give you access to a GitHub repo with, you know, all sorts of presentations, other stuff I make available for free up there if you want to go and have a look. The summary is that, you know, my analysis of it is yes, it's great. It's really the people that will get the most out of this are creators, people who create documents, create PowerPoints, create reports. It's not going to be really for those who are data processing, who are just entering numbers, who are delivering packages, driving trucks as yet, right? The AI will be in the background for them. So focus on those users inside the environment and sell it to them initially. Prompting is really important, like asking good questions in the search engine. Same thing here with the prompting is going to be super, super important. So spend some time learning that. There's not a lot for a partner to do in the back end with Copilot, right? You turn it on and that's it. You apply it to a user, off to the races. Now, there is an admin capability, the e-discovery, the viewing of what people are asking. All of that, yes, is available. There's not a lot at this point in time that you need to do as an admin, largely apart from turning it on. The majority of work or the opportunity is making sure that the permissions, the data labeling, the compliance, the security is all in place, which should be done anyway, I would suggest. So that's where the opportunity is largely for MSP partners, I would suggest at this point in time. There will be opportunities with Copilot, but it's not going to be with the Copilot license. It's going to be about helping people get the most out of it with Word, asking it the right questions. How do I integrate it with my CRM? How do I integrate it with my phone system and so on? Okay, so don't think you'll make money selling licenses of Copilot. You won't. You won't not going to sell a lot, I don't think, initially. You're not going to make money really admining it once it's gone in and in play. The money, I think, is going to be around making sure the base is in, the permissions, all that sort of stuff, and then assisting people with prompting. At the end of the day, this is only the beginning, right? So yet another service available that provides opportunity. Like I said, it's not for everybody initially. It will grow, it will change, it will enhance over time. So hopefully with the presentation, you've got a little bit more information and understanding of, you know, what's going on here. Unfortunately, as partners, especially in SMB partners, you really don't have a lot of options to get access to the product apart from buying it from an annual situation. There are other options, gray options, black options, all that sort of stuff. But at this point in time, the only real legitimate, you know, option, unfortunately, is for you to buy it commercially with a credit card, put it in your tenant, start using it, let it build its semantic index and start using that and use it every day, and you will find the benefits. But I would suggest to you that by the end of February, I think a lot of this hype will have died down. I think it'll just sit in the background and bubble along. Yes, there'll be some customers it really speaks to, but it's not a for everybody product at this point in time. So you're going to hear a lot of hype from Microsoft, a lot of hype from Disties. My advice to you is treat it pragmatically. Yes, understand. Yes, learn the product and start using it and get familiar with it. And there are opportunities, but not to the level of hype that is out there, in my opinion. Now, obviously, that could change over time. Now, the final thing that I will say before opening up for any questions, if you might have any, is Security Copilot. Security Copilot is currently being evaluated by a limited subset of customers, read enterprise, high-level enterprise customers. However, I think it is, if you look at the videos which are in some of the links that I've provided, is, for example, Security Copilot can analyze incidents, it can take automatic actions, it can tell you what PowerShell scripts the attackers are using, how they got in, it can create in-tune policies, it can troubleshoot in-tune policies, it can adjust troublesome in-tune policies, it can manage devices, it can do so much, turn security on and off. So to me, all right, whenever it becomes available, no ideas as yet, Security Copilot is going to be worth every single penny if you're focusing on cybersecurity for your customers, because it's going to mean you've got the power of all of this intelligence, all of this AI, and all you've got to do is ask it the right question. So if there's one Copilot, I would strongly encourage all MSPs, IT pros to pay attention to, it is Security Copilot. Unfortunately, we don't know when, we don't know where, we don't know how much, but I think that's a far bigger game changer than the current Copilot for Microsoft 365. There are opportunities, but to me, the security one, when I saw what it could do with Intune, it was like, oh my God, this just makes Intune so much easier to work with, and you get all the benefits of the power underneath it without the clunky interface over the top. So hopefully I haven't waffled too much and you've got value from all of that. We still have the recording on, so be aware of that. As Andrew did point out, yes, Copilot for GitHub is an additional cost. It's relatively cheap. I think it's 10 or maybe 12-ish dollars. So if you do write a lot of code, if you do want to use it for that, well worth it. And again, my point would be not necessarily for everyone in the business to have a GitHub Copilot, but probably worthwhile for, you know, the key people who write code or debug PowerShell or whatever, to have a license for them. So it's not an everyone license, but it's certainly worthwhile having at least one, I would suggest. So Andrew says here, I'm guessing that this will be required in every tenant, not just yours. I'm not quite sure what you mean by every tenant. The way GitHub Copilot works is it's tied to a GitHub login. Yeah, Security Copilot, we don't know. So my guess will be the fact that it will be an add-on, as always. It'll probably be $50 or more, would be my guess on. My guess would be that you could add it to one user being, say, the administrator, but that user and administrator has to be licensed for the security products like conditional access, Azure AD, P1, yada, yada, yada. So if you are not licensing your admin user in your current customers' tenants, then yes, Security Copilot's not going to work for them. You're going to want to have all your logging set up from Intune, Defender, all of that sort of stuff pointing into things like Sentinel and Defend for Cloud Apps so that it can read from those. But yes, I think you'll be able to buy one license and you'll be able to use it. Obviously, you can't use that with others, but I don't see why, if you have an administrator doing the admin-y stuff in security, that they couldn't have the license assigned to them and you use that. But again, unknown as yet, and we have no ideas as to when it's coming out, what the limitations are. But if you have a look at the videos, ooly dooly. If you're a security person, this should just, you know, warm the cockles of your heart. It just makes life so much easier. And there are some links in the video. There are links in there with the videos that show you how it does stuff with Intune. Super impressive. So keep an eye out for that. So Peter's asking whether it can connect to on-prem SQL data. Yep, I believe it can, because it can reach into those via the graph, it can reach into those via Azure Arc. So Microsoft's got a very good hybrid once you set it up, once you configure it. But once it is, it's one homogeneous environment, whether it's on-prem, but it does require setup. And the other thing I would say, Peter, probably it's going to require the latest SQL, okay, or a fairly modern version of SQL. So you're not going to be able to connect up SQL 2005 Express Edition, for example. Okay, but, you know, we don't know yet. It's all, it's all guesswork at this stage, but that will be my guess what it's going to be. So Paul's saying that they're charging Security Copilot preview. It's more than $50. Yeah, I would, again, suggest it's going to be more than that. It includes the full defender intelligence, which I think is around, yeah. So the full threat intelligence is, you know, thousands of dollars, but I'm almost certain that they will probably have a SKU that doesn't, you know, cost that much, because they're wanting to get it out there. They want it to be more secure. They're wanting to learn. So again, we don't know. We just don't know. And it may be $4,000 for enterprise for 300 users like Copilot was initially. And then eventually it's going to come down in price. But we're all speculating here. Don't get caught in the speculation. Don't get caught in the hype. Have a look at what Microsoft's put out there at Ignite and all that. Have a look at it and just keep your ears peeled for when it comes available. My gut feeling is, and it may take a year, I don't know, but I would suggest there will be a version that we'll be able to buy as a add to your own tenant. Again, in a perfect world, I'm hoping that they tie Security Copilot to Azure consumption so that you can use Copilot and just pay for what you need when you need, but pure speculation, we don't know. Now, if you want a demonstration and if you want to know about Microsoft 365 backup, that's exactly what it uses. It uses Azure consumption to charge for doing the backups. And again, that would be another topic we can do for another day. But lots of different ways to do billing. Microsoft is shifting from a pure license cost to adding options for the ability to connect and bill into Azure. So one of my big things for every MSP is you should be putting an Azure subscription inside every tenant so you can take advantages of things like backup, archive, e-signature, all these sort of good things that are coming that we build basically against an Azure subscription. Remember, if you don't use the Azure subscription, it doesn't cost you anything, so now there's no downside to putting it in initially. All right, I make it 8:45. Are there any additional questions that we want kept on the record? Certainly doesn't look like it, so I might paging Wayne Small to the PowerPoint.
Yes, sir.
Paging Wayne Small to the PowerPoint. Do you want to share your screen and round us off for tonight?
Oh, dear. I actually closed that, Rob, because I thought that I didn't realize, but I'll just talk for a minute. Firstly, thank you, Rob, for some amazing presentations tonight. I really do appreciate it. I think there's some serious value in what you've brought to us. And I really do appreciate your knowledge and wisdom that you bring to the table. So thank you for that. That has covered long enough for me to be able to share my screen once more while I mumble those words. But yeah, thank you for that. If you would like to stop the recording so that we can move into our roundtable discussion area.